Today, we're going to be talking about leadership resilience. And the way that we're going to be approaching it will have two elements. One element will be the sort of personal and deeper reflection on ourselves, but we will also be looking at that in terms of the teams. I would like to start with this way of thinking it, that we're in a time of turbulence. We're also in a time of creating an opportunity for transformation. And this workshop is about also finding a path to resilience. And how are we to treat the others? So if you think about that question, just think about that question. How are we to treat others? And imagine that you are sort of wondering about that question. How are we to treat others? And the way that Ramana Maharshi has asked us to think about it is to say, there are no others. So this really is an invitation to understand and work with the differences that we have, but also to work with the moment to find the places and spaces of our common humanity. What I would invite you to think about is, what's the one word that you're coming into this moment with? You're coming into this with a word. And so what is that word? And it may reflect your mood. It may reflect an aspiration. It may reflect an intention, whatever that word may be. Thank you very much for those words. That gives us a sense of where we are amid our curiosity, amid our sense of community, a sense of anticipation. Let's begin to now go into this more formally so that you can get a sense of the flow. So let's talk about the context a bit. We know that the world is in an interesting moment, to say the least. The pandemic has exposed all kinds of issues in terms of our relationship to the planet and our relationship to each other. And in the United States and other places in the world, we're seeing epic protests around racial justice in a way that we've not seen for decades. And all of those things are coming together to create this moment, and we who work in these ways of social justice and service are really feeling this in tremendously powerful ways, where the whole landscape that we knew has literally shifted underneath our feet. And for that reason, many of you are probably familiar with the concept of VUCA, volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. And we're going to talk about that, and we're going to see where you are in terms of each of those terms. We're going to talk about trauma, and we're going to really dig into the understanding and the nature of the meaning of that before we talk about resilience. Because by understanding the nature of the trauma, then we can begin to shift into the work on the resilience. We're going to look specifically at the notion of leadership resilience. A recent Harvard Business Review article provides a pathway for thinking about that, and we've adapted that for our work today. And you'll have an opportunity to talk with each other within your teams about that. Then we're going to drop that into the personal resilience space, and then we'll have a second opportunity once we look over some materials about the nature of that for you to do your own work in that space. And we'll put that in the context of a wonderful concept that is developing, which is called post-traumatic growth, which is the idea that in the face of trauma, in the face of threat, how do we build and use that with resilience? So I hope that is a flow that works for you and works for us as we take this journey for the next 90 minutes. Now let's begin. Many of you know about Viktor Frankl. He was a survivor of the Holocaust, and what he studied in his book, Man's Search for Meaning, is what were those factors that allowed people to survive? What were the factors that allowed people to survive that horrific moment in history? And one of the ways that he wrote about it is, when we are no longer able to change a situation, we are challenged to change ourselves. And we're in a moment right now where the call for changing the situation is very much present. And we at IMAGO believe that that is fine, that we have a focus on changing the situation. But we also believe that it is important to understand where we are and what may need to change about ourselves to meet the turbulence, to bring forward the transformation, and to invoke the resilience. So let's continue to look at how we're going to think about that. One of the ways that we do it is what it means to live in a VUCA world. And a VUCA world really has a very specific meaning. Our invitation in this particular workshop is to think in terms of the globe. There are specifics that all of us will be bringing to this, and we want you to really pay attention to those specifics. That's absolutely clear. But we also want you to think in terms of the common elements of the collective process that's going on at a global level, both thoughts concurrently. So let's look at what we actually mean by VUCA. So VUCA itself, in terms of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, was developed as a sort of a loose concept in the Army colleges here in the United States. The idea was that as in this post-Cold War era, is it going to continue to be a battle between nation states around issues of what we believe is right and good, or are we running into something else? And they began to recognize that organizations and entities that were not state or state sponsored were beginning to emerge that were bringing forward different kinds of conflict, you know. And so this began to say, so what is this? And this was confirmed in the actual acronym for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity came into more common usage with the 9/11 attacks in the United States. VUCA is also a concept that was extended in 2008 when there was this global recession, and the Great Recession really spoke to all of the uncertainty and complexity and how volatile things suddenly became, and real ambiguity about the direction we would go. And now we stand in 2020 and another VUCA moment. So the pandemic and the subsequent social unrest represent VUCA. So let's talk about each of those in a little bit more detail. VUCA, as I've alluded to, stands for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. What I would like you to be thinking about as we're going through these is that, where do you locate yourself? You may say that all four are present, that's true. But in terms of your personal context and organizational context, there's likely one of these that is far more dominant. So as you can see in the top there, volatility is rapid and unexpected challenges. What is key about volatility is the rate and pace at which things happen. And one of the things about volatility is that when something is volatile, it is also potentially explosive. And so when we're faced with a volatile situation, not only are we dealing with how quickly things are changing, we're also dealing with the potential of literally things imploding or exploding right before our eyes. Uncertainty, it says, pending change, known unknowns. What that means is that we know what the factors are, but we're unsure about how we use them. Uncertainty is that the variables that were in place yesterday are still present, but how we work with them and how we understand them shifts. Some of us are facing uncertainty where we had funding sources that were secure for years now shift. because the context around us has shifted. There's uncertainty in terms of when we return to work in the way that we were before. There's uncertainty in terms of the political climate in various countries. So uncertainty is that we know a lot of the factors, but everything is pending at this point. Complexity is exactly what it sounds like. There are multiple key decision factors, but not only multiple decision factors, there are multiple elements that are all going on concurrently. In complexity, we don't even know where to start because there are so many things that could be considered, might be considered, are important to consider in the decisions that we're making. And then ambiguity is the fact that there are too many things that are unknown. And so we have what are called unknown unknowns. In this moment, it goes beyond uncertainty. It goes to, if we move in this direction, we don't even know if that direction exists. In many places and spaces, just the fact that we not only don't know when we're going to work, but the nature of work, the nature of relating to each other, the nature of the actual practices that have been a part of us are all shifting. So if you look at the left axis on your screen here, it says, how well can you predict the results of your actions? The ones at the top are the ones that we can't predict too much. But it also says, how much do you know about the situation? And you can see how that also is there. So we're going to go to the next slide and we're just going to list the words. And so right now, from your perspective, which VUCA condition is most present? Okay, so where we stand right now is that the vast majority of us are dealing with the complexity and the uncertainty of this moment. That's where we are. It doesn't mean that the others aren't present. It just means that those are the ones that dominate. So let's continue with this. The nature of this is a recent Scientific American article that put it this way. Trauma shakes up our world and forces us to take another look at our cherished goals and dreams. We tend to rely on a particular set of beliefs and assumptions about the benevolence and controllability of the world. And traumatic events typically shatter that worldview. As we become shaken from our ordinary perceptions, and are left to rebuild ourselves and our world. And our own responses here very clearly speak to that. That's the challenge that we are all facing right now as well. So let's take this and look at it a different way as well. When we begin to think about this, it's hard to really say that this is trauma, but trauma simply means and an inescapably stressful event that overwhelms people's existing coping mechanisms. That's the classic definition by a scholar named Bessel van der Kolk and his colleague Fissler, but van der Kolk was the scholar in this area. And so the nature of a pandemic in particular is that it's an inescapably stressful event. I don't know about you, but there have been moments where my existing coping mechanisms have been sharply challenged. And as we get deeper into this workshop, we're going to allow ourselves to have a conversation about that. But it's the next definition of trauma that I really want you to see, because this has been one that I think really speaks to the complexity of what we mean. And it allows us to locate ourselves in it. It is the unique individual experience of an event or of enduring conditions in which individuals' ability to integrate their emotional experience is overwhelmed, such as his or her or their ability to stay present, understand what is happening, integrate the feelings and make sense of the experience, or the individual experience subjectively, a threat to life, bodily integrity, or sanity. This more complete definition of trauma allows ourselves more likely to be able to locate ourselves or the people that we serve in it. Because what it speaks to is the individual experience of the event, but it also speaks to the notion of an enduring condition. And these conditions are not necessarily only in the individual context. It is in the deeper and larger context of the societal praxis or the societal shift that we're encountering right now. And what it does is that there is a threat to life. And life doesn't necessarily mean life and death in terms of the corporeal body, but it also can mean that sort of existential understanding of what life has been before. So let's continue our thinking about this a little bit. And what we notice is, and I want you to pay attention to these, how many of these have you seen in yourself or in others? I repeat, how many of these have you seen in yourself or others? The shock of dealing with the protests, the pandemic, and all the consequences that go with it. Denial, a wish to push it out of consciousness as if it is not really there. Anxiety, and that shows up in the ways that we are able to sleep or not. The ways that we feel a sort of like a low grade sort of sense of trepidation with us all the time. Unpredictable emotions, meaning that the sort of way that we are used to presenting ourselves in the world, the level of containment that we have around that, then shows up in kind of edges that we thought we knew how to contain, and then they begin to erupt differently. Flashbacks, going back to earlier moments of experience that were very much like this. Things that we believe that we integrate, but then in reality, they are still very present and embodied in us in some kind of way. Strained relationships. Wherever you are on the continuum of the quarantine, there are likely moments where even when we're in places with the most beloved people in our lives, there has been some kind of strain, some kind of edge that begins to show up. Physical symptoms, headache, nausea, are kinds of things that show up. If you didn't used to have headaches, you're suddenly finding you're having that, or a certain level of nausea, dizziness, discomfort, that is not characteristic of your experience. And then my absolute favorite, rumination. The sort of wondering about the what ifs, the sort of thinking about that. So that means that we are either experiencing this directly ourselves, and as we talked about last time, that trauma has an intersectional nature to it, which means that it can be something that is present in us, and it also can be something that we witness. And then we still have the vicarious experience of it ourselves. So let's continue now. What we know, and now we can say all of us, are included in this, is that already before the pandemic, when the data that you see are present, is that adults in the general population, 70% already have some degree of trauma. But what we also know is that of that 70%, 20% go on to develop a post-traumatic stress disorder, which is the ongoing experience of the symptoms that we just talked about. Before the pandemic, already 90% of healthcare workers were experiencing trauma. And I think we can safely say that that number is now at 100%. And then many of you work in contexts where you work with refugees, asylum seekers, people who are on the margins of their respective societies. And we know in those situations, 100% experience trauma. So what is important about that is, as we go on here to the next slide, is that it is present, it is powerful, it is something that we understand to be present. Resilience is then, in the face of the trauma, then how do we begin to move from the trauma and the experiences of oppression? How do we break through? How do we become that seedling that is so strong and so intent that it breaks through concrete? Resilience, from the American Psychological Association, this is sort of the classic definition, is resilience can be defined as the ability to adapt well and bounce back after facing adversity, trauma, tragedy, threats, or significant stress. But let's take that definition a little bit further. And this is the one that I've been working with, is from this Working with Resilience Consortium in Australia, is the capacity to manage the everyday stress of life while staying healthy, adapting, and learning from setbacks to prepare proactively for future challenges. That's the part that's different, is to prepare proactively for future challenges. So this isn't simply the bouncing back to a previous state. It is also proactively preparing for those future challenges. Leadership resilience is really has two elements. It has this facilitating and sustaining elements to it. We're going to talk about that. So there are two ways that leadership resilience shows up. And this, I want you to think more in terms of your team context. Is that which one of these will be your focus? As you think about your team right now, think about the vicarious or direct trauma that we're all going through. But now think more specific about your organization. Which needs to really be developed further? Has it been that the levels of confidence and abilities have been shaken? Is that the need right now, is to focus on these areas? Is it about disciplined routines for our work? Has something about both working virtually under the intensity and stress of a pandemic, in the face of protests and unrest, have the discipline routines been affected? Or has it been that the presence of social and family support, the networks that sort of undergird us, have also been challenged? What we know is that if all three of these are present, then a team's capacity for resilience is dramatically increased. And the way that I have been working with this, and I did this in my own organization at the University of San Diego, is that we looked at this and we recognized that for each of us on the team, there was a different one that we really needed to work on. And so at the beginning of the lockdown, of the quarantine, we each made a commitment to work in one area and developed with each other accountability partners so that we could support each other in attending to these. So I'm asking you to do the same thing right now, is to think about which of these would you like to be either your personal focus or you believe would be essential for your team to have as your focus. Levels of confidence in our abilities, disciplined routines for our work, presence of social and family support. And for me, just so you know, that when I began working with this, there was an absence of disciplined routines in the face of the virtual space. And so I had an accountability partner, and she and I are still working on that as something as my focal area. Now, the next part is also the sustaining factors. So it's wonderful to know what makes it sort of easier for you to deal with being resilient in the virtual space and in the pandemic and in the face of protests. But in order for this to be sustained, there's a leadership responsibility that each person here has. And leadership can be thought of in two respects. One aspect of it is actual functional authority and role. The other part is what we're talking about in terms of you leading yourselves. So think about these. Display compassion in the face of a pandemic, protests, unrest, virtual space. How much are you displaying compassion? Recognizing that there's a degree of suffering that people are experiencing relative to their previous level of functioning. And so are you demonstrating care first for the communities that you're a part of, the organizations you work in, the people that are closest to you in your life? The next part is then making accommodations. One of the things that we who work in education have discovered is that even when we provide some young people with a pad or a computer, that doesn't necessarily mean that they are ready to move into this virtual space of learning. We discovered that there were thousands of people where I live in San Diego who never engaged in the virtual shift in schools because there were so many other elements going on in their lives. So there are other kinds of accommodations that were needed to be made in addition to making sure that there was the technical aspect of having an iPad or a computer. There are also accommodations in terms of how people function that are needed as well. And then the last one is guiding the conversation. One of the key factors in terms of resilience in virtual space and resilience in terms of a pandemic and resilience in terms of a time of unrest is to have the courage to guide the conversation and to demonstrate genuine concern for others. That also means that the silence in these situations can be, as the protesters are saying, a form of violence, because then it is not allowing an opportunity for these difficult and complex conversations in this uncertain time to really be something where we move from ambiguity to clarity. And so how do we guide those conversations? That we're experiencing trauma isn't just the personal level. I alluded to the fact earlier that we also have the vicarious, where it's indirect, but it really hits us. A pandemic represents the collective, but also what we're seeing, and they're represented in the protests, is the sort of historical or systemic elements that come forward. And so graphically, if we look at the next slide, what we see is that, think about you. Right now, you are likely in the middle of all of these, where there are personal elements that are impinging on you right now. There are the people that you serve that are also experiencing something of this. We as a globe are having a collective experience. And there are historical forces that are hitting this all at the same time. And what happens because of intersectional trauma is that we do not know where it's coming from. How much of this is my own history? How much of this is because of what I just witnessed? How much of this is because we're all in this at the same time? And how much of these, this moment, are whispers of previous moments? And so the next slide then tells us that if you see these things, inability to manage the uncertainty of this moment, increasing unfiltered thoughts and behaviors, unwanted intrusive substance of shadow, which that means that the stuff that you thought you'd put away shows up again, and unhealthier psychological defenses, that is what happens when there's intersectional trauma. The people who are most vulnerable in society right now are more likely to have personal expressions of intersectional trauma, meaning that they're more likely to carry the symptoms of the trauma, but it is coming from a variety of circumstances all at the same time. So as we're thinking about this, as we're thinking about resilience, it's absolutely key to recognize that these intersectional forces are here. So let's continue to say, okay, let get us out of this, please. Okay, so the next slide then begins to say, can't get out of it yet. Okay, so why can't we? Because intersectional trauma shows up in four distinct ways. I'm going to start at the one at the bottom, which is called reflection. Reflection is the nice belief that this moment provides us a way of being able to step back and to step into ourselves and to gain meaning and purpose to this. That's great. And that's the highest level. But in reality, some of us also experience the regression. The last time I did this, somebody said is that when you go to college, you gain the freshman or first year 15 pounds. Some people are calling this the COVID-19, meaning the 19 pounds that people have gained because of the regression of moving into just really unhealthy behaviors that you, but it makes you feel good. And so you watch Netflix, eat the ice cream, have too many that bottles of wine, not the glass of wine, that kind of stuff. But there's also psychologically the sort of repression, the really trying to hold this out of consciousness because it just gets to be overwhelming. But then the last part is rejection, and that's basically denial. That's the wish, desire not to see it. So if we look at the next slide, then it gives us a sense of how this works. So you're at the middle of this, and so the rejection is the part that's closest to you. Because if the trauma and the stress is hitting so hard, then what you want to do is just deny it. I can't deny it. Well, then let me at least try to push it out of consciousness. Okay, well, I can't do that. Let me eat an ice cream cone or a donut. Okay, and then the last part is like, let me get to a point of reflection and journal and meditate. We're trying to go with this is in the healthier level, which is that notion of reflection. And so, yes, most of the time I do reflection, but I also slip deeply into the regression. That's what happens with me. So let's take this a little bit further and to see how we're going to go with this. So when we talk about personal resilience, what we're trying to do is help each of us get beyond the burnout. Because what this is isn't the burnout from caring and compassion and being out there so much and then not attending to self-care. What we're talking about is that we're in a pandemic and we're also in a moment of social upheaval. And so therefore, the notion of personal resilience beyond burnout has a different kind of meaning. So what are you talking about? So let's take that further and we'll see how that works. These are the key ones: authenticity, purpose, adaptability, self-care, support, energy, and networks. These are the kinds of factors that are needed for resilience. And so what I would invite each of you to think about is that during this period, how much are you practicing any of these? How much are you doing authenticity, purpose, adaptability, self-care, support, energy, and networks? So I'm going to go into these in a little bit more detail. So when we say authenticity, that means, are you really living in accordance to your values and deploying your greatest strengths? Because this is basically, are you living into a space of your own emotional intelligence, where you're able to regulate those emotions, have awareness of where you are, and work from there? Are you able to work with your calling or your purpose? And what I mean by that is that, are we really feeling the sort of sense that our work is aligned with our core values? Maintaining perspective. Is there an adaptability, as an optimism? Are we able to reframe these setbacks? And are we able to step out of the negativity that impacts us? The next part is, number four, the next slide is mastering the stress. That means the self-care, so that when work and life are in one space, how are we able to still find the space for relaxation and recovery? Are able to develop routines around that? Are we interacting cooperatively? Do we have both cooperation with the people that we're working with, but also the support that really brings us together in a different kind of way? And then finally, the last two factors are the energy, in terms of the fitness, the health, the diet, the sleep, and then the networks, making sure that we have the personal and professional networks so that when we're at home and we are doing our work, we're able to do this well. Beginning to build this resilience. You're really beginning to recognize that this resilience is actually something very common, that we're not talking about psychopathology here. And what you're really beginning to discover is there roots to deal with this in the face of these confrontations with disruption. And so what we hope is that you're beginning to figure out that there are psychological and physical elements of the trauma, but you're also beginning to build that resilience. And so if we take it a little bit further, what we want to talk about is that this has been a metaphor. And the way that we want you to think about this metaphor, some of you might already know about Kintsugi. And that is this centuries-old Japanese practice. And when I was first introduced to it, is someone just walked into a workshop and she shattered this piece of pottery and we went, and then what she then explained to us is that, yes, it's broken, okay, but what about being able to not think about this as something that's thrown away or thrown aside, but it's something that we can make beautiful. And then she showed us another piece of work where the gold and the silver was intermingled along the cracks so that there was this beautiful whole piece of pottery. But the broken history was an element of that. And so all of us, to some degree or another, have in this moment experienced this brokenness. And so let us talk about some ways, very briefly, to get out of this. And that's post-traumatic growth. Post-traumatic growth is this idea that there's creativity in the face of the adversity. And let's talk specifically about what this means. And if we go to the next slide, it is that these are the kinds of factors, and you just practice that, where appreciation for life, finding our strengths, connecting to our compassion, looking for new possibilities, having awareness of those strengths, finding our connection to practices, and for some of that is around our spiritual development, creativity, artistry, are ways that we can grow in this moment. More than half of you said that reflection is the key to what you're doing. And post-traumatic growth says, in the face of trauma, where are these opportunities for growth? These are the factors, and you've been practicing those for the last 20 minutes, and you've been moving into the space of these. The next slide then tells us then that the research indicates that most people would prefer not to have the trauma, but guess what? We all live through this pandemic, are living through this pandemic. I don't want to give the illusion that it's over. But then we have the possibility of being able to grow from this. But if we didn't have this, it would be sustained faster. But that's why we talked about sustainability factors. How do we sustain learning in the face of this? How do we adapt and transform in the face of this? But the last bullet point here is the one that I want to emphasize, is that even in the face of post-traumatic growth, what can happen to all of us and to the people that we serve is that another blip in the pandemic, increased violence in the protests, things of that sort can traumatize us again. So even if we have these growth factors in place, the trauma can break through again. So please be aware that it is often the common circumstance that we can get triggered again. Okay, and then the final place I want to go with this is that each of you then have these elements. So what you have right now is that you've identified facilitating factors for yourself. You also identify sustaining factors. You know something about the trauma that you have, but you also have begun to look at ways that you can move out of that with resilience. So these are the kinds of key considerations, and we want to give you this as another tool to think about, is to identify the immediate stressors that you're experiencing, how to begin to move that into reflective practice so that you begin to work towards this kintsugi notion of healing and wholeness. And so the next slide gives you a 1, 2, 3 on this. Okay, so if you think about the word ear, okay, engage, assess, renew. Engage, assess, renew. How do you help people engage the strengths that they have? And then how do you help them assess their progress? And then finally, how do you help each other renew your resilience? That's what we've been doing for the last hour and a half, is we've been looking at what their strengths are, recognizing that there's trauma, beginning to identify where the progress is so we can assess that and renew this. So again, you have yet another tool that you can take with you and to work with your organization. So if we can go to the next slide, this is where we want you to be left. Those who have a why to live can bear with almost any how. Those who have a why to live can bear with almost any how. Thank you for your work. And the way that we'd like to close is the way that we close in IMAGO, is that this journey of this 90 minutes has taken us to someplace, and we have a word that's with us that sort of characterizes where we are right now. And so with that, our workshop is ended, but our work continues, everyone. Let's do it with resilience.